Welcome to the Shaftsbury Select Board on this Monday, July 6, 2015. First up, does anyone have a conflict of interest with anything appearing on the agenda tonight?
No.
We're operating with a skeleton crew, at least here behind the table. Ken and Tony cannot make it, and David Kiernan is homesick, and I told him to just stay there and not come back. So we'll, I think we'll be able to stumble through anyway. Approval of minutes is next up on the agenda.
Make a motion to approve 6:15 minutes.
Second.
Any discussion? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Minutes for 6:15 are approved as circulated. Warrants. We have a big old warrant here that includes a lot of end of year stuff in the amount of $228,698.23.
I move we approve.
Second.
Seconded by Mitch. I'm going to go for the really big items on here. We've got Blue Cross Blue Shield for $2,500. We've got Bennington County and Bennington County Shaftsbury ID to the tune of $13,000. I believe that is David here. I couldn't be sure, but I bet that's a tax bill. We've got a sheriff for $1,800. Bennington Tire Corporation. Two bills at $2,400 and $9,900. I guess something needed tires. I didn't hear what that was. Did you?
Sounds like a grader.
It sounds like one of the big machines.
Yeah. We're.
We'll have our man here in a little while.
Steve will be here any second. He can fill us in on which big piece of equipment blew tires. Bergerson protective clothing. This would be for the volunteers. $1,743. David Hosley roadside mowing $10,000. Ed Schull construction $2,400. This is the construction going on downstairs. Yeah. Endine, $2,900. Doesn't ring a bell with me. I want to say it's
a folder.
Oh. You want to see if you can find it? Yeah.
Leaf bowler. That's Hosley.
Okay.
Benny County tax warrant was for the aggregate fair amount for that $11,223.
Okay, tax warrant, yep.
There's two of them.
Sheriff.
I'm sure they're annoying. Here's a Bennington County. Goodyear drive axle truck. I don't know what that means. Grader. There's a grader for the $9,900.
Okay. Tires for the grader. All right. You see an Endine in there.
Bergeron for the fire stuff. Endine. This is the calcium chloride and so forth. Right? Chloride.
This is laboratory services.
Oh, okay.
So.
KAS, KAS Inc., is that the water? Testing. Landfill spring up. This is the spring checks. They're checking all that.
Oh, the annual,
yes, inspection.
Semi-annual thing that we do to check the wells around the landfill. Good, okay.
Volatile organic compounds with oxygenates. That was a big one.
All right. And we've got Green Power for 1,200. We've got 38,000. It says John Deere credit.
That's a capital payment for this year. This is one of the...
John Deere credit, yeah, one of the truck payments.
Yeah.
And then the Kansas State Bank for 46,000 is probably one of those,
yeah,
too.
Yeah, John Deere was for the grader.
Okay.
38. And what was the other one?
Kansas State Bank.
Usually they're in order.
Yeah, that was nice of them.
Kansas State Bank for the John Deere loader backhoe.
All right.
I think this is like the last payment, or one of those anyway.
Yep. All right. We got 2,000 for sycamore mowing, which is Lance Cemetery mowing. We've got 6,300 at TAM. We've got 4,800 to Vermont League of Cities and Towns. To VRS sales. Do you see that one?
Is that Vermont League of Cities? I don't know who did that.
VRS.
VRS, Vermont. Vermont Leagues and Towns?
Further down from that, it's after Vermont Leagues and Cities and Towns.
VRS sales, here we go.
Shaftsbury Fire Department. Okay,
so that's floating strainer. Oh, that's for the fire department for this new strainer we got.
Okay.
Float, they put in there.
And then several bills to Will's Insurance.
Yep.
And, Wilmington, the town attorney. Any discussion on the warrant? All in favor of approval, say aye.
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 Motion is approved, 300. Here, a retirement warrant in the amount of $6,846.98. I move we approve.
Second.
Seconded by Art. Any discussion? All in favor say aye.
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 The motion is approved, 300. Retirement warrant in the amount of $91.90. Move we approve.
Second.
Seconded by Mitch. Any discussion? All in favor say aye.
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 Motion is approved, 300. Repulsor kennel. This would be animal control in the amount of $558.33. Motion is made by Mitch.
Second.
Seconded by Art. Any discussion? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Motion is approved, 300.
That one's already been signed there.
Huh? and payroll in the amount of $16,000, let me go ahead and get payroll number 26, $16,662.34. Move we approve.
Second.
Seconded by Mitch. Any discussion? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Motion is approved 300. Warrants. Are there any announcements?
I'll say a quick announcement for the chicken barbecue in August at the Historical Society. Get your tickets early. Only 120 available.
Very good. What's the date on that again?
August 22nd. It's 4 to 6:30. We have Seth Bongards coming down and giving a talk on the second inauguration of Lincoln. And the open house starts at 4, we'll eat chicken about 6, and Seth will come on about 5.
Very good. Any public comments? All right, first up, item 7, Cemetery Committee Bylaw Changes. Ken Kunrat, please come up.
All right. Who's here? Is that in?
Over here is the usual, but if you'd like to put your back to the sun, you're welcome to.
This is just to catch you guys up on something that we should have done some time ago. Back in December 21, 2009, we met with the select board, and Chairman McClintock was there, and we discussed the rates for cemetery, right? Cemetery sales, and corner markers, burial fees, and administrative things. And it was decided at that time that the new rates should take a new rate should be given. So we decided they decided on new rates. The recording fee would be $25. The lot fees would be $500, up from $300. And the administrative fee for corner markers went to $150 for 4 markers, and the administrative fee or burial fee was $100. That was up from $70. We went ahead and started living to those new rates at that time, but we never updated our bylaws to include those new rates. So we observed the fact that we had not done that a while back, and we said, and I've been working on a new Shaftsbury Cemetery bylaws anyway, so I cranked the new rates in. Oh, and here is a copy of that select board minutes, the page out of that minutes that is where we where they decided on the new rates.
I guess there's one for him.
Oh, okay.
So since about
this is a discussion of new rates with the cemetery committee, but it looks like it's not the motion was not passed at that time. That's why you're here tonight.
Yes, yeah. So we've been working to the new rates for 5 years, mm-hmm. almost 6 years. I've been on since April 2010, and so this new bylaw has those new rates and a couple of new things in here for the cemetery bylaws. This probably should say draft.
Mm-hmm. So what is new in cemetery bylaws?
Okay, the only thing that's different, well, the new rates are on the last on page
right,
5.
The rates.
One thing that I've added is page 4, which lists all our public and private cemeteries.
Yes, I found that helpful. I don't couldn't...
We just thought it was a good idea to include that. And the other, the two things, and then the rates are on page five. And two new paragraphs, 17 and 18 on page five, on page three. We would like to prohibit artificial flowers. Artificial flowers have been a real issue for a long time. Usually when they're placed, they're just stuck in the ground, and they fade, they come out of the ground, the wind blows them around, and they're just a nuisance. Mm-hmm. We have no objection whatsoever to real flowers, flower pots, pots hanging on hooks and that kind of thing. And when I sell cemetery spaces, I make it clear that we prefer not to have artificial flowers.
Okay.
There are a few, not many. Most of the flowers we have in the cemeteries are real, either annuals or perennials. There are a lot of perennials out there. There are a few shrubs, as I'm sure you've observed. Mm-hmm. We just felt like it's time to just, let's not have artificial flowers.
Okay.
And the other one.
Common rule on.
Yes, most cemetery. Now Bennington also prohibits artificial flowers. Okay. I'm sorry.
What's the definition of bordering or fencing?
Okay, that's coming up. Some people like to put 2x4s or 2x6s around a little area in front of their headstone. And some of them are pretty bad looking things. We don't mind if they put stones or pavers, as long as they're flat with the ground, so you can mow over them. But when they put borders in, often grass grows up within them, and it's not very long before they look terrible.
Okay.
So we call that bordering and fencing.
Okay.
And that's the only two changes to this. The bylaw.
What's your opinion on shrubs that are planted and just all of a sudden are bigger than everything else around them?
Covering up the
headstone.
I try to encourage people to keep them cut back so you can see the names on the headstone. And I talk to that whenever I sell spaces.
Okay. But there's nothing in here about that.
Okay. No, there isn't anything about shrubs. Okay. Matter of fact, we had a burial in the village here about 6 months ago. And the people that own the lot brought it to my attention and asked me, did I cut them down? So I cut them down for them. You could not see the, and it was a big stone. You couldn't see the stone.
Yep.
They had a couple of arborvitaes that had just overgrown the stone. Yeah.
Okay.
Let me ask you about item 7 in the bylaws. It says an outside receptacle in addition to the burial casket is required for burials. The receptacle must be fabricated of sufficiently rigid materials so as to resist collapse caused by the weight of the earth, moisture, snow, grave markers, and cemetery maintenance equipment.
Yeah, that's the vault.
That's your vault.
That's a concrete vault.
It's mandated by the state, I would assume.
Yeah, that's federal. Yeah, that's
a concrete
and state law.
Yes.
Casket in the vault.
Yep.
Or they,
if it's a conventional burial, you have to use a vault. If it's a cremation, all you have to have is just the urn or whatever that might be. It could be a cardboard.
So we don't
box.
Just put a casket in the ground, we put it inside a concrete.
You have to go in inside.
Box.
And the vault has a cover which has a rubber seal. One of the things that the funeral home people have to do is assure that it does seal, that it when it's put on. That it's put on, not crooked, but it seals down so the water can't get into it.
Hmm. Yep. So the ground doesn't cave in after.
Right.
Okay. Well,
if you've been in Maple Hill or Waite, and the village, you'll notice that some of the old cemetery spaces, plots, they're sunk. You know, the old caskets just. Mm-hmm. Deteriorated and the ground sinks, and we do a lot of filling and seeding down.
Hmm. Yep. Well, it's just recently, I only ask us out of really idle curiosity, but recently I was hearing on NPR an article about natural burial or green burial, where people were looking to, you know, wrap in a shroud and bury their loved ones so that they would decompose and become, you know, part of the earth and all of that, which was just something I hadn't thought a lot about, and I was wondering if do we really think that it's a state law that we have to have a concrete box?
Yes, it is. Yeah, I believe it's federal law. It's in the Dig Safe, which is a federal handbook. It's in that. And whenever
people are being buried in green graves, natural burials, so it must not be a federal
property.
Law.
Probably not in a town cemetery.
Oh, maybe probably on personal property?
Yeah, probably.
We had a burial in North Bennington not too long ago. Well, it was actually in Shaftsbury, in the North Bennington area. They had to go to the state to get permission to plant on their own property.
That's right. State.
And the funeral homes arrange that. They do all the paperwork, get the approvals and all that.
I see. Okay.
And I'm sure that would be the case if anybody wanted to do a so-called green burial.
Mm-hmm. All right.
Now, in cremations, a lot of cremations are with nothing more than a cardboard box. Although the majority of them are in pretty nice porcelain urns or concrete urns. Some of the urns are actually put in a casket, in a small casket, usually made out of not a concrete, but a compound. Very sophisticated situation.
Have you heard Chris Williams' comment about the $100 burial fee?
No.
Would you like to talk about
Chris, you want to come up and tell us your opinion on the $100 burial fee?
Thank you. I spoke at your last meeting on this subject, and I just feel that the burial fee is nothing more than a death tax, and that actually was a political issue a few years back where it referred to something quite different. In any case, you know, tracing this through the town report, it appears last year we took in $1,500 at $100 a clip. 30 people died. We collected from half of them. I think that
You said we collected only from half?
Well they were those are the ones that were buried in town. Probably the other 15 were buried out of town.
Oh, okay.
Yes.
Okay.
It wasn't that they got buried without paying.
Okay, because I know we haven't had any that didn't pay.
Including me.
So far.
So, I don't know. I mean, I just find this to be a kind of, it's an abhorrent kind of tax, and it doesn't represent it. You could characterize it as a user fee, as Tim did, and that's certainly a fair characterization, but on the other hand, it doesn't raise very much money. It hits people at a bad time for everything, and it seems like we should just roll that $1,500 into either the lot fees or the general operations of the town in some way.
What do you consider that $100 to pay for?
Well, I consider that the administrative fee for when we get that fee, I consider that for documentation of the death. We require a death certificate, and not yet. A death certificate in the case of a cremation, a copy of the cremation certificate, and then documentation in all the of any of the books that we have that document an index of all the people who own cemetery lots, and then when there's a death, we document in that book when, how, whether it's conventional, whether they're veterans, whether they're non-veterans.
Yep.
And then it's documentation is made for input to the computer, and then index cards are made and put in the vault. So that's an administrative, yeah, I prefer to call it an administrative fee. I don't see it as a tax.
Yeah, okay. I just, I don't think the select board can, since it's in their, this is their decision, I don't see as we can override that.
Oh, I think we can.
Okay.
In fact,
that's been in there at least back to the 70s. We've had a, what we call a burial, a burial fee.
Yeah, as it states on the first page here, the cemetery committee bylaws are approved by the select board, so we can change that should we choose to. I understand what Chris is saying, but the way I look at these, I don't see any of these fees as being exorbitant, and they're all for part of the service. It's not like we're just picking up extra cash.
Most of the people probably don't even realize they're paying that fee, because when they are counseled by the funeral home, they just throw all kinds of things in there. They charge for the number of chairs they have at a wake.
Mm-hmm.
You know, they put all kinds of charges in there. So, but that's one of the things that they roll in there for the person to pay. So,
yeah.
Is this more for like to keep separation of the, you know, administration? Obviously, you say it's an administration fee, or basically. And
the reason that we do all this documentation is that for 30 years down the road, somebody might come in here and want to know about Cairo.
Yeah.
And they can go to the book on Maple Hill and look in the index and find out where that at and find out where exactly she's buried. And they can go to the death certificate. They can find out when the cremation occurred. So it serves as kind of a reference for anybody in the future to find out, you know, what has occurred, when it occurred, mm-hmm. that kind of thing.
Yeah.
So I'm confused as to what you're looking for. You're looking for approval of these being put into the bylaws. Is that what you're?
No, I'm just looking for a final approval of the bylaw, because there's a signature block in here.
Okay.
Yeah, the bylaws. These bylaws were approved 5 years ago. They've been operating by them, but they were never actually voted by the select board.
I have a copy of the last one that was approved, which was. I only have one copy of this. It was approved when I was on the select board in April 1999. It was Barth Vander Els, Tyler Resch, Alice Miller, myself, and Art Ferris.
Okay.
And that was on in April. So.
I make a motion.
We have a motion to approve the cemetery bylaws as provided by Ken Coonrat. I will second it. Any more discussion?
So I just a little bit more. I mean, I understand that the documentation, it needs time and effort. And we can't really roll that into the cost of the thing, because you got to keep track of it separately. I mean, do you keep track of the burial fee separate from the administrative fee, or you just say it's $1,150 or whatever?
Yeah, it is. As a matter of fact, there's a separate line.
Mm-hmm.
When I receive that check, and I always require that the funeral home gives me that burial fee check. Usually, and in a lot of other cases, the individual gives it to me, unless they have given it to the funeral home. So that check is signed, it's initialed by me, initialed by a town clerk, and then it goes to David, and I guess to the treasurer. Because
mm-hmm.
we need to assure balance and accountability for not only the sale of spaces, for the corner markers, and for the installation of the corner markers. And all those things are separate line on the budget.
Maybe if you include, on this one it says administrative burial fee was 100. Maybe you should put an administration up here, and that would make it a little bit. I mean,
where
on the old on the minutes of what was approved before? Well, what was mentioned says
okay.
Administrative
yeah.
burial fee yeah. for $100. It was 70.
Mm-hmm.
I think that might. I could see Chris's point that it could be just like piling on,
mm-hmm.
but it is work. I mean, and it's good to have the documentation,
going forward generations, I, you know, for generations.
Are you suggesting that on this sheet that I put?
Administration.
Yeah, just put.
Administrative burial.
Administrative burial fee.
You're making a motion to change the description of burial fee to administrative burial fee?
Yeah, and it looks like it was always, or $70, that went up 5 years ago to 100.
Yeah.
It's not like it was completely new. And it does define it a little more. This burial fee is like open-ended. It's just, it's almost like it's like.
And I understand Chris's point. It does. I have no problem with that.
It seems.
Well, I mean, consider.
I'm going to second Mitch's motion so that we're in discussion about the amendment to change the description.
You've already got a motion on the floor.
Yeah, now we're amending that motion to, the motion on the floor is to accept these bylaws. We have a motion to amend these bylaws to describe the burial fee as an administrative burial fee.
Okay.
Chris, sorry.
You know, my experience maybe was a little out of the ordinary in that my daughter was killed in Anaconda, Montana. She was cremated in Missoula, Montana. I flew back with her ashes, threw my feet on the plane, and it sat on a shelf in my house for a year and 10 months. And last Sunday we buried her in Maple Hill Cemetery, and there was no funeral home involved. There was no funeral per se. There was a group of family and friends that gathered, a very small group. It's just a private ceremony.
Yeah, and I would like to say, with regard to Chris, when we talked about him buying a space, I simply mentioned that since it's Maple Hill, most of the old stones up there have a certain design. And Chris had a stone made that fits right in with the design of the old stones, and that's very much appreciated.
Collins stone with like a Collins stone, Zerubbabel.
Well, it's a hand carved stone, as all the old stones are. Mm-hmm. It was done by a stone carver in Tynemouth, out on the back roads, back behind, way down long gone.
And he did Rick Kovacs as well for his wife and child.
But through the miracle of the internet, you can find this guy, and he does business all over the country.
Did a great job.
He's a wonderful carver.
Super.
So I got a slab of Dandy Imperial white marble, and a year later produced a stone book.
All right, we have a motion to change the bylaws to the description of the burial fee to administrative burial fee. Any more discussion on that amendment? All in favor of the amendment, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. The amendment is approved 300, so burial fee will now read administrative burial fee. We are back to discussion of the bylaws in general. Any more discussion there?
No. Chris, I think with this conversation, it was $70, and it has strictly to do with the historical aspect and documenting it. And as you know, that stuff takes time and people to do. I guess I got to support the bylaws and the increase that it was. I understand your dilemma and concern, but I if it had gone from nothing to $100 the last time and they talked about it, I might have said something, but it was $70 for that service before.
All right. Well, all I'm asking, Mitch, is that you rethink the thing.
Mm-hmm.
And you disinclined. So, you win some, you don't win others.
That's what our democracy's all about.
Right. I'm so used to not getting my way. I have great practice in this area.
Yeah, I agree with Mitch that I understand what you're saying, but I do feel that these fees are to cover the cost of the service, and I think they're reasonable. Any more discussion? All in favor of approval of the Shaftsbury Cemetery Committee bylaws as amended, say aye.
Aye.
the bylaws are accepted.
I will make that change and give the master copy to Dave. He can get your signatures, and then I'll distribute. And this will be passed out to anyone when they buy a purchase say, or they'll be available
in the town
downstairs for anybody who wants a copy.
You have this on a computer somewhere?
Yes.
Yeah. If you can get that to us, we can make this change. We can make that change on this page and not affect the signature page. So let's go ahead and sign this to get that job taken care of.
Okay.
I just want to say that it's been great dealing with Ken through this whole process. He's really a great guy in this position as cemetery superintendent.
Thank you, Chris. Appreciate it.
Thank you, Chris.
Appreciate
thank
it very much.
Thank you, Chris.
Now I can follow up with you, Chris, and collect the money. Oh, thank you very much. I do need to bother you for, if you can, provide the copy of the certificate. Thanks, Chris.
I'm going to put July 6th on here.
Yeah,
July 6th.
Would you do that? Thank you. All right, Ken, anything else for us?
Oh, sure. Thank you very, very much. Appreciate
thank you.
It.
Thank you for your much. Service to the town, Ken. We
yes,
appreciate
thank you.
It. Next up, we have Treasurer's Report. Melanie Dexter, welcome. So, did we end the year where you said we were going to end the year?
We ended the year pretty close to where I said. Some other charges are going to come in. The revenue is completely exactly where it was predicted to be, and it's there's just some other money going out is trickling out, but we're going to dip into the reserve fund. It looks like about 70,000. It was supposed to be 120, so we're still ahead of budget.
Okay.
Dave has a better handle on the expenditures, and he's not here, but we talked about it at just the bottom line. It looks like that's mm-hmm. about where we're going to end up.
Okay.
The big concern now is that we're going to run out of money pretty soon, which I guess happens this time of year every year. So I've gotten the paperwork going for a line of credit for the tax anticipation. Mm-hmm. So I guess this happens every year.
Yep.
So I've got all of the paperwork here. It needs to be signed in three places.
Mm-hmm.
It's to get $340,000, which is considerably more than we'll need, just to tide us until the tax payments start coming in October.
Right.
So we need to sign on page 1, 3, and 5.
I'll make a motion to accept the tax anticipation note for $340,000 to get us until November.
Second.
Any discussion? Let's see. I think
they have to have.
I think we have to have three motions here because we have to sign three things.
Okay.
So, Mitch, whether he realized it or not, just made a motion to sign the tax anticipation note line of credit in the amount of $340,000, seconded by Art. Any discussion? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. The tax anticipation note is approved 300. Then next we have a resolution for tax anticipation borrowing line of credit. I move we approve.
Second.
Seconded by Art.
That just affirms that the select board did approve.
Yes. Yeah, it states that the select board is approving that we borrow money in anticipation of taxes. Motion is made and seconded. Any discussion? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. That motion is approved 300.
Okay, she signs up here. Okay.
then the final piece is a non-arbitrage certificate tax anticipation borrowing line of credit.
Motion to approve.
Motion to approve by Mitch.
Second.
Seconded by Art.
I know what it meant.
I think non-arbitrage means that we do not intend to take this money and use it to make a quick buck.
A capital, or, oh, that's
right. Not going to reinvest it.
Reinvest it, yes.
That's my understanding of arbitrage, yeah.
Yep.
Any more discussion? All in favor, say aye.
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 The non-arbitrage certificate is approved, 300. Anything else you have for us?
So, any questions for me?
Yeah, can you print off one of those lists of everything at the end of the year just to show us the plus and minuses of all the budgets, just items, just a line item, just for to have on hand?
Sure, I actually have, I mean, because if that's what you mean, you can have that one.
Yeah, that's kind of what I was looking for.
To see where we're over.
Yeah, just kind of keep it for next budget.
Yep.
Okay.
That's fine. Yeah, that's the, I printed that out after we closed the book, so that should be completely
okay.
Current.
Thank you. You have that electronically then?
Oh, sure, yeah.
Can you send that to the selectmen?
Yes.
Okay, good.
Thank you.
Anything else? All right. Thank you, Melanie.
Okay, thank you. Now we can actually cover that warrant.
Yes.
Kind of did the car before the horse did race.
Very good. All right. Interim road foreman report. Steve Washburn, welcome.
Evening.
So I was out of town last week, but I was getting the VT alerts about the heavy rain we had, and I got a lot of gravel at the bottom of my driveway. I guess you guys got some heavy rain here.
We did. Sunday with some heavy wind, lots of trees down.
Maybe yeah, you worked most of the day Sunday, didn't you?
Yeah, Monday, Tuesday, to get that cleaned up. Weather hasn't been our friend over the past few weeks. Kind of went backwards a little bit.
I didn't notice any roads that I traveled on that really took a beating, except
East Road was the worst.
East Road was the worst? Yeah. Okay, then.
With the wind and the trees and everything,
just
right?
On the hills, got some washes and stuff we got to deal with.
Yep.
Oh, okay. Yeah, I thought the roads around where we live seemed like they were in pretty good shape.
They were.
There was a couple of spots on Rolland for just a
short section,
few tens of feet where it was running down the road, but not enough to wash away very much.
Seen it a lot worse, that's for sure. Yep.
So what's the plan?
We got an upcoming paving project for East Road, looking into some trees getting caught up there. Got about 120 feet of culvert that needs to be replaced before they pave it, reclaim that section.
The culvert, side culverts or crossroad
culverts?
How many of those?
Four.
Just four?
About 30 feet long each. Mm-hmm. So there's some work there to do.
And you guys will do that?
Mm-hmm.
So you'll dig through the pavement to put the...
Cut the pavement and dig the...
Put the culvert in, yeah. And then they'll come along and...
Pack it, and then, yeah.
Tractors will come along after it and
yes.
Do the paving.
We got new tires for the grader?
For the Cat grader.
Which one? The Cat? Yeah. Now we got to keep it running, don't we?
Yeah, we do.
Got more money in
it. Needed them.
Mm-hmm. Is that the second one we have, the older one?
Yeah, older Cat, yeah. And we're still continuing with ditching and trying to grade when we can in between the raindrops.
And what was the other tires that we got? We got the grader and the other, was it the?
It's just truck tires.
Trucks.
We approved a warrant to pay for truck tires and the grader tires.
Okay.
Do you have a pan, vibrator, a packer to...
We have a compactor.
You have a compactor, good enough.
Plate and the little jump and jack stuff.
Yep, good enough.
Tamper.
Mm-hmm. It's important. It's important that they really pack them after they dig up the culvert and put the culvert down.
Oh, yeah. Otherwise, you'll get a dip.
Blacktop.
But you said the state would do that as part of their...
No, we have to do all the...
That's our responsibility.
You put in 8 inches, tamp it down, put in 8 inches, tamp it down.
Yep.
Build it up.
And lift.
Is that a piece of equipment we have, or do you...
We have those.
Do you have one for your, just a hand one, or do you got one for your machine?
They're both actually hand operated. One's a plate compactor, a wide one, so for bigger stuff. And the other one is a smaller plate compactor, jump and jack kind.
Corners and edges.
Yeah.
I just know that some things were put in without that. Okay. No comment.
And I guess you've got some major work planned for Potter Montgomery.
Yeah, that needs quite a few yards of material drawn in to just give the road some shape that we've lost over the past few years.
Okay. When do you anticipate doing that?
I'm going to try to do it towards the end of this week, okay, as well as the holes at the end of North Road. Get the hot mix put into those, clean them out real well, and hopefully it stays in there, rather than just try to keep putting a cold patch or something in there. It's not a permanent, but it's more permanent repair.
Yeah, I'll just mention to... For those playing along at home, that normally on the website every Monday morning we update the website to indicate what road work is planned for this week. David Kiernan usually does that with Steve comes in and tells him what he plans to do for the week, and then David puts it up on the website. We sent David home sick today, so that I don't believe got updated today, but it'll get updated as soon as David is well enough to type.
Mm-hmm. We've also started putting together, doing some measuring for some fabric projects around town that need to be finished. And unfortunately, they're a lot longer than they look by the eye when you measure them, so it's going to take a few years probably to do them. But I should have something put together for the next meeting. We can actually hand out and see what we got.
Okay. Projections. Yes, good. Yeah, I'm very interested to know where we're really in need of rebuilding the road base and how big a chunk is a near-term problem.
Okay. Good. These are just areas that happens every year. Sometimes it changes from year to year, but even in sure. Every year, these certain sections happen.
Yeah.
Okay.
Because they don't have the fabric now.
Right.
You just fix them and
yep.
pile them, and then they go back.
Next year, do it again.
All right.
Very good.
Good. Thank you, Steve.
Thank you.
Truck insurance update, that was just going to be a report from David, and what he told me is that we're nearing the end of the fiasco that has been our new tandem truck. It was offered, he said, that we could send the truck. The last thing we talked about was we think the truck is sound. We think if you put it in the sunlight and look at the paint just right, that it doesn't look factory new. It's got some rough spots in it. It was offered that we could send it somewhere to have it buffed to try and make it look smoother. My opinion is, as soon as it drives down the road and gets covered with dirt, you're never going to see that, and I'm not inclined to think that's necessary, but that's something that we could have done if we wanted to.
Yeah. I wonder if he's got any warranty on rust through the surface other than the factory warranty. You know, like 5 year or whatever, 50,000 miles, or I don't know if they do that on commercial trucks or not. Seems to me that...
Yeah. I think that's a valid concern. I don't think buffing the outside is going to affect
that.
That's
not going to do anything for that. I'm just thinking, seeing if the job was good enough, if it starts rusting through in a year and a half, do we have any repercussion?
That's a good question, and I don't know the answer to that. I have a feeling that if I understand how insurance companies work, I believe they'll say if you accept it, you accept it, and that's kind of where we are. David also told me that in the end, the total amount of our insurance claim for that fire is going to be in the low thousands of dollars, as it turns out. But he said they are, Delores is saying that we need to replace all three radiators in front of the truck, because they got dented when they were put in, and they think that should be replaced.
Radiator cooler, the transmission cooler, and the hydraulic cooler or something?
Probably.
Three different units?
Yeah, I don't know.
I think even the painting company, the company that painted it, even stated in their invoice or their documentation that the paint job was a failure. Is that not right?
I had not heard.
In one of the reports, I think Dave reported that that's what he was looking at, the paint job, and that's why they offered probably to buff it.
That's right.
So maybe.
I mean, we do
have a little recourse.
But again, that is going to be on our insurance company, so which means that the insurance company has to go after somebody else.
Yeah, if a year from now there's, or surely 5 years from now, the paint starts peeling off of that truck, I think we're just, I doubt we have insurance against paint peeling.
Yeah. I agree. Yeah. I agree. But I think we could send the truck and have it, had the paint job upgraded, I guess is the word I would use, and not get any static from the painting, the company that painted, because their documentation states that it was not successful.
Ah, I see what you mean. So we could get yet another paint job on
yes.
it that would be considered factory fresh
versus a buff. That versus a buffing it out,
yeah,
or a complete.
I guess I would like to ask my insurance, our insurance company. Yes, it will be paid for by our insurance company, but then they have to go and get the money from, they have to sue or negotiate with the insurance company of the paint company to get paid. We aren't going to be paid by the paint company. We're going to get our satisfaction through our insurance company, who then has to go out and negotiate with everybody else. I want to make sure it's not going to be show up on our.
We don't want to stick it to Wills to get a better paint job, you're saying?
Or you aren't going to stick it to Wills, because later on our rates will be higher because you had these claims. They always come back and say, look, this is the claims, you know, this is what your claims were.
Mm-hmm.
Whether or not they get that from the paint company, I don't know if that's ever noted.
Okay. Well, I had not noticed the line in the thing that said that the paint job was an admitted failure by the company.
I haven't seen it. Dave just indicated to me that he has that. So.
I think it was more in conversation. I don't know if it was in the minutes or not.
Yeah. Well, we'll pursue that. If they're saying we got a lousy paint job, mm-hmm. by the people that do it, I think we might want to think
yes.
harder about it.
That's my point.
Yeah, because, like we say, we're not too concerned about the fact that it's a little less shiny than a factory fresh one. What we want is that 5 years from now it's not going to start falling off.
That's right.
All right, so let's make an action to pursue that.
And a talk with our insurance company, too, just to say, what does this actually mean?
If we say accept as is.
Or does it go against, or does it show up as a claim on our account later on, even though they were able to get it from the paint company?
Okay. Good. Okay. Item 11, surplus computers for SES. At a school board meeting a couple of weeks ago, there was we were trying to get a presentation up that the kids had done to thank the school board for sending the fifth grade to the Nature's Classroom, which the school board agreed to help out the parents who are fundraising for that. And I noticed that the computers in the library were really, really slow. It took a long time to get that up, and started poking around and realized that they have some really old computers in the library. They've since replaced the one that drives the smart board, but they still have a few computers around there that are in the 6 to 9 year vintage. We recently upgraded all the computers in Cole Hall over the last few years, the last batch, to make sure that they were not running Windows XP anymore. They're sitting under desks, collecting dust. They are maybe 50% faster than the ones that in the library at Shaftsbury. And I would like to make a motion that we surplus those computers that we're not using to Shaftsbury Elementary School.
Second.
One other point, just so people don't think that all the computers at Shaftsbury Elementary School are 9 to 10 years old. Shaftsbury Elementary School now has one-to-one computing, that every kid has a computer in grades 3 through 6. And to their credit, they prioritize the computers in the library below getting the kids on, getting computers in the hands of the kids. So this will help them out a little bit for a year or two. They are, those computers are scheduled to be replaced, but it'll be a year or two before they get to it. So they're a little faster than, the ones we have are a little faster than what they have.
And we aren't using them.
And we're not using them. Any more discussion on that?
Yeah, are you gonna delete the files on them and
yes,
format the disk hard drive stuff?
Yeah, we'll I'll probably do that. Just reformat the drive before we turn it over. In fact, I was suggesting to the IT guy over there that they buy a new drive for them, which is probably a better idea because that's always the first thing to go. And if they can afford a solid state hard drive, which you can get them for $30 or $40. They'll probably run faster. So.
Plug it in, plug and play.
Yeah. All in favor say aye.
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 Aye. All right. The motion to surplus computers to 4 or 5 computers to Shaftsbury Elementary is approved 300. We got fuel bids. We got 3 fuel bids. We're ready to award those fuel bids if the select board is ready to make a decision. What David has suggested is that Robert Green has supplied the fuel oil for the building here for the last several years. Their pre-buy bid is fractions of a cent different from Haskins. So he was saying, just for the sake of continuity, that we approve Robert Green Inc. for the fuel oil for the building, and go with Haskins for diesel and for propane. And we pull up the documents that said what we've done in the past. Previously with Robert Green, we went with the pre-buy for fuel. For diesel, we went for cost plus, the cost plus route, and then propane, we went with the pre-buy. I don't know why we chose to go with cost plus.
I don't think they offered it. I think it was all the bids that came in for diesel fuel, I think, were cost plus, but I'm not sure.
Okay, well, Haskins is offering a pre-buy.
I'll make a motion we do the fuel pre-buy, diesel pre-buy
at $2.19 a gallon from Haskins. The one at a time? Or do you want to do it all in one motion?
If we're, I think we're all on the same page.
I don't have any problem all in one.
All right, so.
Well, I'm kind of going with what Dave recommended.
Yeah, all right, so Mitch is moving that we go with Haskins in a pre-buy arrangement for diesel and for propane, and with Robert Green in a pre-buy arrangement for fuel oil. The pre-buy price for diesel from Haskins is $2.19 per gallon. For propane, it's $2.90 per gallon. From Robert Green, the fuel oil price is $2.25 per gallon. Any discussion? All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
We probably don't pay road use tax and all that sort of stuff on the diesel. Is that right? Are we exempt? That's a really low price on diesel fuel because they're usually about 40 some odd cents taxes. But
maybe in a
municipality we don't.
I'm not sure.
I don't know the answer to that. Yeah, I thought that was a low price. So.
Well, it's actually lower than the heating oil price, which is unusual. Because there's federal and state taxes on top of that. So I'm just wondering if we're exempt or actually is he just bidding us the actual rack price and we have to pay the taxes on top of that.
Oh.
But maybe we aren't.
I think that's the price we pay. They take care of it. I would think, I haven't heard anything about us paying taxes on diesel consumption.
So it must be we don't pay taxes.
No, I don't.
I'm surprised we don't have to pay federal tax.
Who knows, maybe he's getting a good deal.
Could be.
See if I can bring up from last week his bid.
Is there a date? Is there a deadline we have to let them know by?
6/18 I just saw on that one.
So that is that before the next meeting?
6/18, where did you see that?
Before, if you go back to the original. Up on top, price 6/18/2015. So okay, so this is the price he quoted us on 6/18.
Okay.
So and that was when we opened up the bids, I guess.
Oh no, those came in on paper that we opened last week, so I don't have any of those details. So well, I think
$2.19
is a good price. We
yes,
should go for it.
It's there.
Yep.
We have it documented. So
there it is in David's spreadsheet.
Okay.
All right. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. All right. The motion to purchase pre-buys on all three fuels is approved. 300.
There it is. It was in the minutes last week. We need to make sure it wasn't a typo or something.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Financial audit. As we said last week, we got two proposals on the financial audit. One from
Sullivan Power.
Ron L. Ballou, I'm guessing, which is the company. Maine, who offered
decreased second and third year rates.
Yeah, they offered decreased second and third year rates, but that was dependent, their rates in general were dependent on just 30% discount, and the asterisk on the 30% discount says please see billing terms. And the billing terms include this clause that said we need all documents provided to us electronically.
Mm.
So, and I think the consensus in Coal Hall is that would be a burden for us. And so we could accept the 30% increase, and then I think we're looking at comparable numbers with the other company, which we'll talk more about in a minute. But we're still talking about people who have to come from Maine to do this job. The other company offering to do this is Sullivan and Powers in Montpelier. And their rate sheet, is at the end? And so they do not offer the, their initial year is pretty close to the main company. The main company's big advantage was they were offering discounts in second years. This company is not doing that, but again, if you add that 30% back in, those second-year discounts are pretty comparable to what we're looking at here. And the advantage here is that this is a company in Montpelier. If they need to come down to go through our stuff, they can drive down, do stuff, drive back in a day if they need to. And David said that they have done our audits for us before. So I would move that we accept the proposal from Sullivan Powers and Company in Montpelier to do the annual audit.
The next 3 years.
And yeah, do we need to decide that now? I don't know that we do, but I think we've been advised by previous Treasurer Bill Fisk that it's a good idea to do an annual audit, and I think it
especially when
helps streamline the paperwork and is probably a good idea.
I'm not against that, but I hate locking the next select board into a decision that we make.
Okay.
Unless somebody thinks the rates are going to go up significantly more than that if we don't.
Yeah, I don't think we have to decide tonight on
all three.
I
agree. I just
since we're, you know, if it's something we want to debate further, let's do it when we have the full board here.
Yeah.
But I think it's fairly non-controversial at this point to go with Sullivan and Powers for an audit.
I agree.
This year. Yeah. All right, I will make that motion.
Second.
Seconded by Mitch. Any more discussion? All in favor say aye.
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 Aye. The motion to go with Sullivan and Powers for the town audit is approved 300.
For 1 year.
For 1 year. Thank you.
That doesn't seem as if you lock in with Sullivan, you get any deal.
Is that something that's actually done here, or do we ship a lot of paperwork up to them, or do you know how that's? Because, I mean, do they get $200 an hour for traveling? Because usually that's how that works, too. I mean,
yeah.
If it's a principal person coming down, it's...
I don't know.
Okay.
Yeah, it's a good question. We can follow up on that. Insurance renewal.
We paid the invoice for that tonight.
Yeah, I think
probably his final payment.
Yeah, I think
well, that was
we were just being advised that we were renewing the insurance with Wills again. I don't believe there was any anything we had to sign there.
I think we went with them last time, and that was, I think, one of those bills that he paid up front for this first start of 20.
Right. Let me check and make sure, because I know I have something from Tam that we need to sign here.
Yeah, it was in there. Will was in there.
We didn't vote on going with approving next year's insurance, did we?
I think we did a couple meetings ago.
Over
VCLT. I think we did approve it over VCLT.
Yes, we did. What period does that cover is what I'm trying to say.
Starting from June 7/1 to 6/30. So he just loads it. Why this warrant is so large is because they front load all their expenses in beginning of the year.
Well, I believe the answer to your question is we generally rebid that every 3 years, I believe.
That's okay. So it was a 3-year policy is what you're saying?
So,
1 year.
I think it's a 1-year policy, but we don't rebid it every year. So maybe we should just pass a motion to continue with Will's insurance.
Okay. I think that makes it official.
Yeah. All right. Okay. So Art will move that we accept insurance again this year from Will's. And I'll second it. Any more discussion? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. The motion to continue with Will's insurance for a second year is approved 300.
Okay.
The TAM contract we saw last week, we had handwritten the changes onto it. The only changes were the rates, which went up just for inflation. And we said we would get those typed in and come back this week and sign them. I have that here. It's been approved. And so we just need to sign it to make it official. Was going to talk to us a little bit about that, but since he's not here, he said it's not critical. And then item 17.
Does anybody know about have we got any bids on the well or anybody advised us on the well?
I heard from Dave. He said none of the well drillers would touch it until they got an engineer study.
Yes.
They won't even come in and look at it until they get an engineer study.
Yes, and Dave has been talking with Chris Panessi, who is going to do an engineer study. And initial talks with Chris Panessi, it sounded like he was going to do the engineer study. He thought a well could be drilled for $6,000 or $7,000, and it sounded like Chris was going to recommend also that we install the UV purification system as a backup. But he thought that was going to be $2,000 to $3,000 range rather than the $5,000 range, and that the whole soup to nuts drilling a well at Howard Park to provide a well, which Chris Panessi says is what we ought to do, mm-hmm. was going to be around $14,000.
That's the plumbing and the pumps and
yep,
it's digging and everything.
Yeah, is that with the UV? I'm not sure why would you need a UV if you get down far enough.
Just a public water system.
It's probably the public water system bit. Yeah, at home you can decide to drink a little E. coli, but we can't do that with a water fountain.
Oh, the bank won't let you.
Bank won't let you at the park. Yeah.
I mean, depending on the amount of casing they put in down to the bedrock, it really shouldn't be any leakage, and kind of an ongoing maintenance expense. If we do put the UV in, I'd like to know from Chris why we would have to do that if it's going to be drilled to engineer specifications today and so forth.
There'll be lots of discussion about that.
Yeah, we can talk about that. If if we get a well in and it's got a good test.
He did say Chris was going to take a look at it, but did he say he was going to
should that go out to bid? The engineer is about $2,000 to $3,000 or something for a wastewater permit, $1,500 to $2,500.
Yeah, it's going to be $2,000 to $3,000. It doesn't have to go to formal bid. Policy is that we would seek a few competitive bids on that. My inclination is to go with Chris because
he's local.
He's local. He's on the DRB. He knows what we're going to need to do.
There's other people in town too. Maybe they can do a better price. You never know. I mean, I don't know. Just informal bid. But
you do make a good point, though. If we would do well to make a motion if we're going to set aside policy on seeking competitive bids on that $2,000 to $3,000 engineering job. And if you're inclined to,
I'm just saying he is on the DRB, so this will come up in front of the DRB, so he'll have to recuse himself.
Right. Which he does regularly.
So I mean, if we could get someone else, he could evaluate it. I mean, use him for his expertise on someone else's work or something. Something to think about.
I know we gotta be fair, but we've got to move on this too. This could take another month before we get a bid and all.
You're dealing with A&R. It could take you 6 months.
Well, my point is, the quicker we get going on it, quicker Chris or somebody gets going on it, the better off we are.
Yeah.
So, we need something.
Yeah.
So, and I prefer to go on it quickly.
Yeah. All right. So Art's making a motion that we go with Chris Panessi to do the engineering study for the well at Howard Park.
Wouldn't that be the WW wastewater water delivery and wastewater permit? That's kind of what they call the WW permit.
All right. The WW permit for a well at Howard Park. I'll second it. Any more discussion? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
The motion to go with Chris Panessi for the
Wastewater and Water Delivery System.
Wastewater and Water Delivery System permitting and engineering for a well at Howard Park. That motion is approved 300. The bid proposal for exterior painting at Cole Hall, that was just the job description that David wrote up for seeking bids on getting the exterior painting done at Cole Hall. Everybody saw that there? Does it look good?
Yep.
All right, then I move that we allow David to go forward with the request for bids on exterior painting on Cole Hall with the description that he's provided for us.
Second.
Seconded by Mitch. Discussion. All in favor say aye.
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 Aye. The request for proposal description is for exterior painting at Cole Hall is approved 300.
I have noticed the ads in the paper for administrative assistant or treasurer's assistant or whatever, financial coordinator.
Oh, good.
And another one also.
Yeah, and I was reading in the paper today, was it Dover?
Yeah.
They just hired a bookkeeper.
Yeah.
So it's all the rage. We don't have a town administrator for his report. Is there any other business? All right. Reviewers.
Oh, wait a minute. There's other business, I believe. There was something in there about a contract with CAI up from.
Yeah, that was in the. In
Dropbox.
The Dropbox. I'm not sure why that was in the Dropbox.
Apparently, our 3-year contract ended at 4/1/20 or 3/31 or 3/30/2015. I don't know. I just want to talk about it a little more and put it off till next meeting.
Okay. Yeah, because it wasn't clear to me why that was in there, and we didn't put it on the agenda. So let's. Let's get some more information on that. Mm-hmm. I was on that topic. I was talking to Jim about the the error that you caught on the web, and it was a, it was not the kind of errors that these guys have been correcting for the last several years as mm-hmm. they digitized that. There was a column in the grand list that describes a subdivision mm-hmm. that was not being read when they did read from the grand list to the information on the web.
Conversion error. They dropped off of the sub-01, yeah. sub-02.
Right.
And yeah, but there was that was the one I found. But the other one was the opposite. I found the one where my lot or the lot was is a listed on the map correctly, and but the description was wrong. And then there was another one where the lot was listed correctly, but they showed an acreage of 200, you know, 10 acre lot and the description, and that was correct, but they had the lot on the map at 264 acres. So there were the two different, one was one way and the other is the other way. And I mean, reading in this thing, it just says that there's some sort of, they will, I think they said review, provide us with any errors. I just perused this really quick because it wasn't on the agenda. Or shall we do it? Yeah, I just get some more information. I just like to know. I want to make sure it's, we mm-hmm. got this maintenance contract. How do we know what we got right now is good? I want to make sure that's good before they.
Yeah. Well, you work in software as I have too, and as you well know, getting every last bug out of there is more of a pipe dream than anything else, and so
well, that's a lot of 1,800 it. Properties. It wouldn't take long for our listeners or someone just to go down and bang me. Yep. I mean, that's what I've been harping about, I guess. I think it should be some review. Obviously, there was no review when they first put it up. Or okay. Maybe there was. There were spot checks, I'm sure. And then okay. most of the spot checks would have worked. It's the ones that are... You can target the ones with the subdivisions if you want to do those, but the other one, I don't think it was a 00. It was a 2-1 and an 02 and an 01-1 and a 13. I don't know. I can't remember.
But you think you found another error that's not related to that
first one I talked about?
Subdivision column.
Well, no, it was actually a placement on the map. The lister, if you've looked at the site, there's a lister area, with listing area, which has all your property, values, homesteads, acreage, and then it shows you on the map where that is. Mm-hmm. So, in one instance, the maps was right, but the listing area was wrong. In the other instance, the listing area was right, and the map had the 0113, blah, blah, blah. It had 10 acres, which was right over here, but the map had a parcel that was 264 acres.
Okay.
So I'm not sure if that's exactly the same thing. To me, it's not.
Okay. But all right, well, we'll talk about this some more, and it probably, I'd like you to show me where this area is, and let's see if we think we have more of it. All right, that gets us down to review of action items, and the only thing, two things I caught that we were going to ask more questions about the paint job on the truck, and if we think we've got a truck that's got a factory warranty on the paint job, essentially, is your concern, right? That the paint job is going to last as long as a new truck's paint job.
And if we do want to get it painted, we're not going to get dinged for it by the insurance company.
And if we do say we want a new paint job on it, is that going to be charged to Wills and then affect our insurance rates? And then the other question is that Art was asking is if when we do an audit of the town books here at Cole Hall, is it done at Cole Hall or do we box up everything and send it to Montpelier, or is it some combination of both? And we can ask both those questions.
I have a feeling whatever they take, they'll always come back for more.
If Yeah.
No, I just have a problem with somebody getting in a car and traveling 3 hours and charging us $200 an hour.
Hopefully it's not the principal.
Yeah, hope you have such.
Yeah.
All right, and we're not going to do an executive session tonight as planned because of all the absentees.
Motion to adjourn.
Mitch has made a motion to adjourn. Seconded by Art. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye.